Prince Ali, famous is he, Ali
Got this. Ready?
Oh.
Yeah, yeah, you can clap, okay.
Welcome to Up!
You're...
Go ahead.
Sorry,
sure. No.
Sure,
no,
please, I
please.
Get it.
Please, go ahead.
Every time I try to do that.
You're like, no. Yo, please.
Nah, it's okay.
Welcome to Up, Up, Down, Down. I'm your host, Austin Creed, and today we got something special going on for you. Special episode of Superstar Save Point with your boy, Rusev, a.k.a. Tong Po, a.k.a. Roman Reigns. Now,
Beaks and Freaks! So it's the blood.
We've got a game we're playing, Punisher, on Sega Genesis. But before we start, I wanted to show the world your love for 80s movies. You've got this huge love. Can you talk about that for a little bit?
I love 80s movies.
Yeah.
All right. You said a second, so I feel like limited time.
No, you can. You got some time. When you buy those 80s shirts, you've been going through a bunch of 80s movies recently.
Well, I saw one recently that, thank you. COVID smarting me up.
You got to be educated.
But yeah, so when I was a kid, my mom and dad used to own a videotape store.
Yeah.
So I grew up on all kinds of movies, and that's what made me come to America. But anyways, so 80s movies is like amazing time for all the karate, martial arts, and everything. And Jean-Claude Van Damme was just the man back then, you know?
We always talk about the blood sport, and that was one of the reasons your name was Tong Po and everything.
Yeah, Tong Po, my favorite bad guy of all time.
He's amazing.
He's the best. 2K, WWE 2K, and asked me, what character do I want in the game? And I said, Tong Po Chun Li.
Because that's you.
That's me.
Okay, so let's talk about, you said the movie that Kofi put you on.
Yeah.
Can you talk about this for a little bit?
So I've always heard of a character called Bruce Leroy.
Yes.
And I've never seen it. He was never over back home.
Mm-hmm.
And then I saw a shirt that Kofi, right?
Yeah.
I can call him Kofi.
Yeah, call him Kofi.
That Kofi was wearing, it says Show Enough. And I was like, who's that guy? And he just looked at me with this biggest I just stole something from him. Like,
it was a miracle that you even got to the country not knowing.
They let you in?
Maybe it'll be on the test for my citizenship.
There you go.
And he's like, oh, you gotta know. So he told me the name of the movie, The Last Dragon.
Mm-hmm.
So right away, I got it at night. And he asked me, did you watch it? I'm like, no, I need my space. I need to sit down and watch it. And I had the night after that, and I sat down and watched the movie, and it's the best thing ever.
What's your favorite part of the movie?
Oh, he said, kiss my Converse! And it was so good. It was like this, it's just the best thing. Such
so,
a good movie.
So if you were to, meet Bruce Leroy.
What? I will kiss your Converse. Dude, are you kidding me right now?
Instant gratification.
Oh, I knew I was walking into something. Dude.
This is Converse.
Oh, boy.
Good to meet you, brother.
Man, good to meet you, too.
What?
It's his fault. Yeah. Play Punisher. I knew there was something going on here. Wow, this is like, woo! This is so fresh in my. I just watched the movie and now I see you. This is amazing.
You still got the video?
Of course.
So you got the glow. Can I sit?
Yeah, please sit. Okay, so you guys are in frame here.
We're not gonna play Punisher, right?
You are playing Punisher.
Oh, we are?
Yes, you are playing Punisher.
You're playing Punisher.
I don't play, but I'm gonna try my best.
So.
You're so polite. You still sound the same. Like, you sound like nice and polite.
Well, you gotta teach the kids, you know? Like, a lot of people are showing their children this movie, you know?
Yeah.
Like, when I go to the different events I go to, there's all these kids there, you know? So, you know, you gotta teach them about humility, you know?
Yeah, okay. And you taught them well. When he came and he said, kiss my car, and they kicked you in your face, and you still did your thing. You still backed off and just.
Yeah.
So that got me upset.
So
he still kicked you in your face, and you still kept your composure, which I can't do that.
Right. Well, he was 6'7" almost, and I had to do the best I could. because that was show enough. You know, he had a lot of power, except he didn't have the glow. So
he did not. But you didn't at the time either.
No, I had to discover that. I had to learn a lot about myself, and you know, and a lot of other people believed me, but I actually didn't believe myself until I was faced with such adversity.
Yeah, because even everybody in the movie theater, when the opening of the film, everybody believed in you. Like, yeah, Bruce Leroy is gonna kick your ass. So everybody knew, but you still like kept your, you know, eating with the chopsticks popcorn, which is the most, which is so difficult by itself. And you still kept your composure watching the movie and be like, hey, leave me alone. He challenged you and you still didn't do anything.
I know, I know. Well, his master taught him a lot about how not to have problems, and but Shonoff was had a lot of determination.
But he was good. So, because I was like, okay, I'm watching the movie and all that. Maybe this guy is just a show-off, you know? Maybe he doesn't do it. He doesn't know anything. He just talks a lot because he has his old big entourage.
Well, yeah. Well, you know, I'll tell you a funny story on the set. It was my first acting job, so I had to really understand how to play this lead because I never played anything before, you know? So, he would always come to the set in character, and he had his flunkies with him, and he was really trying to get me to understand that this is real. Mm. And I was like, this is a movie, you know? It's not. At that time, I was a kickboxing champion. I won the New York State Kickboxing Championship, right? So I would laugh at him so much because he was so funny. Every scene he would walk into in character, sometimes he wore the cape, and everybody was cracking up, including me. So he would instigate fights with me, you know? So I would sell him and I would laugh and leave me alone, you know. But I was like, still, it was very funny to me because he was, you know, he was that funny. So one time it was in the motorhome, which there wasn't a lot of guys. It was actually Beast was there, one of the guys that was his flunky. Yeah. At that point, he was kind of embarrassing me. I was young and he was really, you know, making me feel a little bit bad, you know. So I said, you know, listen, it's enough. You know, you're going a little too far. You know? And then he jumped in my face, you know, and of course he's 6'7". And then he saw that I really was getting serious. Mm. I didn't want to, but I was getting ready to hit him. And he ran out of the motorhome. And he ran through the set. And everybody says, get Leroy. He said, get Leroy. And everybody was screaming, no, don't do that. You know, don't do that. So, and then, but later on, they told me, look, he's on Shakespeare. He's a really seasoned actor, not a seasoned martial artist. He's a seasoned actor. You know, don't, just have fun with him. You know, he's just trying to get you, because I was, you know, he wanted that tension to be real, you know. So I said, well, it's real.
And he did it. He got it out of you.
Yeah.
That's amazing. What do you like? Really whooped his butt?
I just wanted him to stop, you know.
And he did. Did he? And he did. That was it. That was the last time.
He did. When we did the scene, he would still mess with me, you know. But at that point, I started to understand more, you know.
Okay.
That you know, yeah. Don't just play like he's the bad guy. Really, let it affect you. You know, that was the whole purpose in the acting. You know, let him affect you a little bit. You know.
One of my other favorite things in the movie is when you were meditating on the roof. You came down through the window.
Yeah.
Mama-san, Papa-san.
Lotus Blossom-san. Yeah. That was.
You were so into, you know, the Eastern culture or whatnot.
Right.
It was just amazing.
Yeah, well, when I was a kid, you know, I'm black and Italian. I grew up in New York and Europe. And when I was a little kid, it was a very tough environment, especially I came into New York when I was about 14, and I got a lot of fights because all you talk lot is my, I had a British accent, you know. And all the kids in the area, they were making fun of me, and we get into fights, and I was really getting serious in martial arts. And after school, I would do my homework, and then I'd rush to the worst area in the whole country, if not the world, was Times Square, 42nd Street. Mm. It was a bunch of movie theaters, and they would have 2-3 martial arts movies for like $2 or $3. And I would just sit in there. At that time, I wasn't eating popcorn and chopsticks, but I was sitting there, and there was a whole culture. And that's kind of how the writer, Luis Venosa, was really playing out in the story. It came from, it was exaggerated, but there was a lot of truth to it, because a lot of these people in the movie theater, some of them were dangerous, but at the same time, they were so funny. We had so much fun. And you'd see these movies, and of course they were dubbed, and you were laughing all the time, but at the same time, unknown to me, I was being affected by the philosophy in the movie theater. I'm sorry, not in the movie theater, in the movies. They were Shaw Brothers movies, and a lot of those Chinese stars were real stars in Asia, but to me, they were stars as well. Bruce Lee and Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
You know, Muhammad Ali was my American hero. Bruce Lee and all the Shaw Brothers stars were my martial arts heroes. It really helped me in my life because there were always these Shaolin monks, and they were always preaching to have patience and all these other things. Right. And those lessons were real, you know. And really learning about oneself, you know. So that it really affected me in my life. And I was very young when I got The Last Dragon, and I really had to experience life and to really grow up and learn a lot more. Mm-hmm. So I didn't get locked up.
You know? No, it's actually New York grew on me a lot since the whole week that we've been here. Because I got to catch a couple of plays and stuff like that. And now that I met you, I think it's...
The icing on the cake?
Yeah, this is that's cool. The icing that's on the cool. cake. That's cool. And I'm so much more appreciative because I just saw the movie, as I said.
Yeah, yeah, these guys, you got to thank these guys, man.
Yeah, they've seen it. They've seen it so many times. I'm sure like Kofi has seen it like a million times before that.
Yeah, yeah, you know, it's a pleasure to me because this movie has been around for so many years. I mean, it's been 30-something years now, and... everywhere I go, people feel that way. And I just wanted to get back to the place where I left off and get another great martial arts film together. There's actually a role that you'd be perfect for in it. And what country are you from? What country?
Bulgaria, but I can be from Asia.
Russia. Whatever you want me to. Yeah, it's not financed yet, but it's in development, and it's called Master. It's about a Persian African baby that's taken away.
Oh yeah, I have ancestry from there.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I grew up in there. I grew up.
Yeah, yeah.
12th century.
The funny thing is, Rusev is the old school 80s bad guy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, great.
He's that in real life. Ever since I've known him, he's just always been like this.
So he wears spandex then?
Yes, yeah. Pretty
yeah.
much.
And not just for work, I wear it at home as well.
Yeah.
I gotta stay committed.
Yeah.
You came with a book recently.
Oh, it's an autobiography.
Okay.
It's all my embarrassing moments in 300 pages.
Nice.
Just for you.
That's nice. The name of it?
It's called Time Up. It's called Time Up, my name, The Last Wreck. Oh, yeah, it's on Amazon.
I will make sure I purchase this movie.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd like to contribute.
Sure, thank you.
You're hot in the convention circuit too, still, yeah.
Yeah, I've been running to a lot of fans and learning about what they want me to do and you know, going to these comics. Actually, I'll be in Colorado Springs. Potentially, I'll be back. You know, Draft House Theater is a very popular theater chain now. Tim League, and they had me come to the theaters, and I did a Texas tour. So right now, I have a booking agent named Syra at Idleworks, and they're talking to her about having me come out again because it was sold out in every city we went to. And
yeah,
I signed my book. We do a Q&A, and we had an amazing time. You know, people come dressed up as Shownuff and Bruce Lee were in Vanity, and it's a blast. It's a blast.
So you're not going there for the search of knowledge.
I'm always searching knowledge.
I'm just going to see my family.
Oh, yeah.
Master, you going to Miami to search for knowledge? Oh, I'm going to visit my sister.
My mother. In Miami.
We met you at, what was it, that Tucson Comic Con, right?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah,
like
a show later in the day, and then there happened to be like a Comic Con event or whatever, like in the building next door.
Right.
So, you know, we're like walking around and we met you, and... it was awesome. You know, like I said, I'm a huge fan of The Last Dragon, and it's always nice when you meet the actual person behind like a film or something that you've, you know, idolized kind of growing up.
Yeah.
Actually good people. So,
yeah,
you know,
thank you.
Thank you for being cool, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do my best. You know, I have my moments, but I, you know, when this movie came out, there was no brothers doing action movies because of the black exploitation era. All the black guys that were doing, you know, from Jim Kelly and Richard Roundtree and Jim Brown, they were these big tough guys, but they needed to see, the NAACP was complaining because they needed to see and show that, you know, black folks were also intelligent and they weren't always involved with violence. dashing out violence and cursing and all this other stuff, you know. So there was a long period of time that you didn't see any more films, you know. And they're like, well, what the hell's going on? That's when Berry Gordy, who was a big, you know, like Jay-Z in the music industry at that time, he was the first one, said, you know, we got to look for a movie with a positive character that really can impact people. And you know, and it was a long, long process for me because I never auditioned for anything before. And, you know, the whole detail of the story in my book. But when I got the role, it was surreal because, as I told you guys, I was hanging out in movie theaters just idolizing these kung fu movies and kung fu stars. And here I was showing up on set to star opposite this beautiful woman and all these amazing actors and Berry Gordy and Michael Schultz. And it's... yeah, so it was really an experience for me.
How did the role come to you exactly?
Well, I was, like I told you, I won this kickboxing title and I was in high school and I was looking at college, but I felt like I didn't really think that, I didn't know what to do there because everything, martial arts was everything in my life. And I didn't know what I was going to study. So I was thinking, okay, maybe physical education, this or that. And then all of a sudden I was at a karate event competing. And all my friends was like, yeah, man, this Berry Gordy, you know, found Michael Jackson, all these people, Marvin Gaye. He's doing a martial arts movie. He's looking for a leading man. And I said, well, yeah. And they go, yeah, you would be perfect. And my heart was like shaking like a leaf. And I was like, well, you know, this dream come true. But then it challenged my confidence because it was not my field. You know, acting. Yep. I just said, well, you know, I guess they want to see me do my thing. So I had my gear in my bag. I was ready to do an amazing demonstration. When I got to the location, it was a small office the size of this room. And the casting director looked at me and said, so you ready? You got the sides? He gave me a piece of the script, put it in my hands, said, go outside, work, and come back. And when I read this scene, it was like he's wearing this hat and he doesn't speak with contractions. He's talking, I do not wish. And I didn't understand anything about this character. I just didn't. And when I went there, I did terrible. And he told me to go home, work on it. Long story short, it was a very interesting story because my best friend at the time helped me laugh about it, but I was very miserable about the whole thing because I didn't get the part. I worked on it. And worked on. I came back and knocked the door, and they already had a guy that they thought they were going to, you know, play the role. But I said, please, just let me read it one more time. I'm working on it. I'm already here. I won't take much of time. And he said, all right. And he was like moving his papers around the office just to make me happy, you know. And then I killed it. And he said, stop. And he called up the production house and told them that they need to have a look at me. And I went down there. And then they fired the guy they thought they were going to sign. He wasn't signed. And they hired me. Wow.
Yeah. Do you know that guy?
Personally? I don't know him personally, but yeah.
That's crazy. So it could have this completely altered your life just because you wanted another shot. That's the story, kids.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
It's just like
never give up. Yeah, always keep.
It's like Rocky. Faith.
Yeah, Apollo Creed.
Apollo Creed, same thing.
You gotta keep faith. It's you get on that journey, and you think it's supposed to go one way, and it doesn't. You know, athletes understand that. Actors understand that if they do a lot of theater, because you go on stage and you think the table's supposed to be there or the actor's supposed to walk in on time. They don't always. You got to keep going. You got to keep going, you know. And you also have to keep a good attitude, you know. You have to find a way. I don't know whether it be religion, whether it be comedy, whether it be anything. You know, work on your attitude because that's going to monitor your talent.
That's awesome. And like Kofi said, there weren't a lot of guys who look like us doing this when we were growing up. So you've been a fantastic role model for us. And then the fact that you are so cool and so humble and so kind. We love getting a chance to meet and hang out with you. We, unfortunately, have to wrap things up right now. I want to thank you for coming in. And
Dude, that was amazing. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure meeting you.
Guys, where can we find your autobiography?
Yeah, I think Amazon is Time Ock, The Last Dragon. And I think if people follow me on Instagram, which is instagram.com/ I am Time Ock. TAIMAK. Then I'm going to be launching a crowdfunding page, Indiegogo page in September. And I will be, for the first time, putting two martial arts pieces on. One is a fight, and it's about philosophy. And the other one is a taste of what master would look like in an Asian background. And I'm in the outfit and the wardrobe. And Yeah, yeah. I mean, I had a long injury. I was doing jiu-jitsu with Marcelo Garcia, and I ripped some muscles, but I didn't get in the shape I wanted to for these videos, but I'm good today.
Actually. There we go.
You guys gave me the glow again. Because I woke up this morning and everything was, you know, it's been getting better and better.
Yeah.
Today was a big leap, you know.
Perfect.
Training, yeah.
Awesome. We got to make sure you follow him on Instagram. Are you on Twitter at all?
Yeah, I do Twitter, but they're all okay. I Am Time Optics.
I Am Time Optics. Okay. Facebook, and links will be below. We got lower thirds and whatnot. Make sure you follow Big Man Rusev on Twitter.
Yes, yes. Only if you're there.
Follow your boy Austin Creed on Twitter at Xavier Woods PhD. Follow the channel on Instagram and Twitter at Up Up Down Down Without the O's. Thank you so much for being on. It's huge for us. We'll close this out. Up Up Down Down. Keep it tight.
Gangsta. In a good way.